Compass sports journalist CIFA Russell Jr. here at the Compass Loft at the building, joined with Cayman Islands Football Association General Secretary Marcos Tinoco and President Alfredo Whitaker. Guys, we have so much to talk about. Obviously, the last few months have been busy with a number of things. I just want to start off first with the upcoming league, seeing that that's in the horizon. We have the season about to start. I'm not entirely sure when that is, but can you just elaborate on that and talk to me a little bit about what are some of the plans for the upcoming season and when it is going to start?
Well, first of all, always a pleasure to be here, and it's good that we're starting conversation about important topics. The league, we unfortunately have to start a week and a half later because of situation with some of the venues, light, and some teams that had some difficulties in their preparation, especially those teams in Westby. So we expect to kick off our season on the 26th of this month with our regular charity shields. Would be between Scholars, the champion, and Bond Town, the FA Cup champion.
It is very challenging to us because, you know, a lot of difficulties we have with the venues. I think is a record in our football season that we have to organize 15 matches per weekend. So it's difficult to accommodate all them. We have this season 6 women teams playing the Women's Premier League. Of course, the 10 men's Premier League teams and 14 first division teams. So it's a lot. We just talked about senior football, right? So, and then we need all the venues, you know, organized and everything working, like floodlights and all the things.
Just out of curiosity, the venues, was there any impact from the recent Hurricane Grace that came through, a tropical storm?
Right? Yeah, well, the biggest problems you have is the floodlights. So the hurricane, I call hurricane because I felt it was a hurricane, right? Grace had some impacts in the building of the floodlights at the CIFA field, so which I believe it delays the floodlights project for about 2 weeks, right? We noticed that some issues at Ed Bush field and Annex as well, so not directly related. The floodlights at the Annex, I don't think, is directly related to Grace, but of course, everything they are doing to in regards to renovation and fixing, you know, the floodlights at those fields also have received an impact from the tropical storms.
You touched a little bit about the Women's League there. I know it was Latinos, Roma, Scholars, Elite, and Sunset. Who is the 16?
And now it's Prospect Academy. And then Fusion was playing combined with Roma, and now Fusion is a CIFA member. So then now they play with their own.
So they're just Fusion?
They're just Fusion, yeah.
Nice. That's a good
16 thing. Women. I don't remember last time I had 6 women teams. If you did.
We continue to grow. Our first season, we had the regular 3 teams. Second season, we have 4 teams. The third season, we had one more team, and this year, we had another one. And also, the first division continued to grow. So this year, we're expecting 14, maybe 15 teams. So football is continue to grow.
Maybe next year, we're going to have the third division.
Maybe next year, we're going to have the third division.
Maybe. Staying with the league, though, last season, we saw that Cayman Brac was very consistent in their league matches, and I just kind of wanted you guys to talk about that and where they stand in the upcoming league.
Well, I just returned from Cayman Brac. I had a really successful meeting with Mr. Sanford. Cayman Brac in many years, and this was mentioned to me yesterday, in many years, over 12 years, is the first time that Cayman Brac actually finished all of the division that they entered, because Cayman Brock would come to Grand Cayman, mm-hmm. play the games, but whenever a team had to travel to Cayman Brock, they would forfeit the game because the team would prefer not to pay. So this year, or this season, CIFA decided that we want the league to finish. We don't want no forfeit games. We want all teams, and especially the young players, to play. That's our goal, right? So we pay for the airfare for the teams. Cayman Brock U18 made it to the final. They should have won that final. Mm-hmm. Cayman Brock first division team completed the league, the schedule, mm-hmm. with a very young team, by the way. Very, very young team. That is overwhelming for us and obviously Cayman Brock. So this year, because of the situation with the U18s and the first division team, at this time, we're still trying to work on something. Cayman Brock would only participate with the first division team. That is pretty much like a U20.
Right.
So they don't have that number of players this year because of age. So they're going to enter the first division team. We're still trying to see how we could work with them and see if we could get that that U18 that for us is important. So was a great success for Cayman Brock. We see a big growth in numbers,
yeah.
and we're very happy, and the Cayman Brockers are happy.
Absolutely, and just kind of going back to the women on an international standpoint, they had a very successful run about a month ago in a friendly tournament that they competed in. I believe it was in
Turks and Caicos.
It was really good to see Cayman shine like that, despite it being a friendly competition. It's been a while since we've had a team so successful on a national level, winning all four games without conceding one goal. Dominant games, by the way. You know, it was 4-0 mm-hmm. victories, 5-0 victories. I just wanted to have you guys kind of talk a little bit about the success of our women teams and where do we see them going. I know that they have some upcoming matches in November. Mm-hmm. Can you guys talk a little bit about that?
Well, first of all, the tournament in Turks and Caicos was a part of the plan for the preparation for the qualifiers that we will be playing in November. But not only that, we want to have the most matches as possible for our teams. Of course, we need to see a lot of different aspects, especially the finances, because it's been very difficult for us to organize international matches or participate in international competitions because flights availability is difficult, so we have to charter flights to go to Turks and Caicos. And our under-20 women's team is going to play in Curaçao. They are traveling next week, Saturday, and probably we're going to have to charter. Well, we will charter another flight because we don't have commercial flights available, regular flights. But talking about the technical aspects of the game, it was excellent performance there, not only because of the preparation. Of course, you have to give credit to our technical staff and even to CIFA, talking about ourselves, that we provided everything that we could for our ladies to perform, but also because they were very committed. They were very united towards the objective to win the competition, right? And then I was like, since we start the final preparations for the trip, and then at the airport and the travels, I see all the girls from different clubs talking together and have some kind of like, you know, I see, wow, this is something great. So the expectations rising. And then when we play our first game against Bahamas, you know, Bahamas is our rival in the region because despite they have almost three times our population, same level of football, right? So, but our team played an amazing game against the Bahamas. The first game, we scored four goals, and then everybody there was shocked at the level of football they play. But I think this is a result of the great program that was built towards relationship between players, you know, and then the result was great.
No doubt the women's team have undoubtedly chemistry between them. And that was evident during their last four games internationally. Switching gears to the men's international team, obviously there's been some issues involving the men's national team and the association. We saw in their last qualifiers that a bunch of them came out and made complaints on the association. And I just kind of wanted you guys to just reflect on that without going into too much details.
Mm-hmm. We had some issues that was created, this is my personal opinion, that was created by a handful of players with the assistance of members or a member of the technical group, right? The good thing and the bad thing about this is that, and the bad side is that they create, for those persons that really don't know much about football, they create this negative atmosphere. Mm. But for the large group of people that know about football, especially former national team players, when they start to hear about the complaints, I receive plenty phone calls, right? And most of them, boy, Alfredo, you're a little too good. And you spoil them. And they're acting out like spoiled kids. Those complaints from a handful of players really will not affect the well put together programs that we have in our national teams.
Yeah, because, you know, what people need to understand is that in any organization, right, you need to have different levels of communication, right? So as the general secretary, as the president, right, you cannot deal directly with each player, because otherwise you would get crazy. You know, we're talking about, we have eight national programs, different national programs, from under 15s to the seniors, right, 17, 20s and seniors. So that's boys and girls and men and women. So that's eight different national programs. So we're talking about almost 200 players. Let's put it this way, right? Imagine if you have to deal separately with 200 different people every day, right? So that's why you have dedicated staff. And these people are paid, right? Of course, you don't pay them full salary because it's not full-time job employment, but they are paid to do this work, right? So these people are connected to their players, so they're supposed to take care of the player. We have dedicated staff for each team. So, and then when I read complaints from the player that say, we did not have enough water to drink, I say, what is people talking about? So we spend $100,000 in charter flights just for the second game at IMG Academy. We paid them $115,000 with hotel, accommodations, and the transportation, food, and then field rental. They have to pay for everything, right? So these people talking about water. You can buy 32 bottle of water for $5, right? So something is wrong here. So then we realized that the players were really misinformed. So players reacted in such a way, surprised us, but at the end of the day, right, when they had a meeting with all the players, they sat down all the players together, and the team came, and we have the whole executive committee there to listen to them, explain to them. We realized there was not much to tell them,
right?
Because they were misinformed.
Right, and I we'll get to that meeting in just a second. But one of the things that one of the players mentioned in that report was the formation of a semi-pro league, and I know that we have covered that. But just for the public, for them
okay.
to understand.
Let me just kill this subject in a quick math. You're talking about semi-pro league. So what would be the wage, monthly wage for a semi-pro player? $1,000 CI dollars? Fine, let's talk about 1,000 CA dollars. So those players receive $1,000 per month. They have to have an additional income because with $1,000 you cannot survive here in the Cayman Islands, right? Good. So we're talking about, we have 10 teams in Premier League. Let's talk about 8 teams semi-pro league, right? If each team have 20 players, so that's 160 players. We talk about $160,000 CI dollars per month just for players. If you multiply by 12, because if you're talking about anything pro, you need to multiply by 12, because people live 12 months a year, right? So we're getting close to 2 million CI dollars, just players. Because if you have a semi-pro players, you need semi-pro staff, you need semi-pro clubs, you need semi-pro coach, right? So, and then that budget will go maybe further than 2.5 million CI dollars per year. And where does money come from? Because, you know, with the population we have, we don't have here possibilities of partnership and sponsorship that can raise this money. And this is a lot more than the whole CIFA budget for the year for all national teams and this and that. So it's just not viable, you know, so it's difficult.
But that is just a small part of it, right? The other small chunk of it is that now you need to have some protocols, right? So, example, you need to have one ambulance at the venue, each venue, 90 minutes before kickoff, and it has to be there until 30 or 40 minutes after the game, right? So if we're playing West Bay, East End, Georgetown, that's three ambulances for about 3.5 hours because we have two games, right?
No, there'll be more. There'll be like 5 hours.
Like 5 hours, right? We would pick up a loss on a weekly basis, like about $10,000, because now you must have a doctor, you must have medical staff, that is not only the doctor, stretcher bearers, you must have, this is not CIFA requirement, this is international football, you must have a scoreboard where you could make announcement, you must have an announcer in case there is any
emergency, any
homophobic or any chanting that the referee needs to stop the game for, it must be there on the screen, and the announcer must make the announcement, right? Our stadium, they don't have the minimum requirement, right, for hosting now international or semi-professional games.
Except for Trumbunbuddin, of
except
course.
Except Trumbunbuddin and West Bay.
Red Bush.
Right, the dressing rooms would have to be a totally different something. And the other part of it, CIFA, like every other football association, are not the one that can implement this semi-professional league. It must be an independent body sanctioned by CIFA, with the president, with the treasurer, with the pretty much the same those that watch football and have a knowledge about football, English Premier League, the FA, La Liga, the Real Federation of Football for Spain, is an independent body that is being sanctioned by the Football Association, right? So it's really easy to say, and I had this conversation with two presidents, right? And I like, yes, but it's not just saying CIFA. It's really easy to say CIFA, but it's not only that.
We had one of the managers report from this meeting that you were speaking. We anonymously received the report, and it highlighted a few financial things that occurred in the trip. What are you guys' thoughts on the financial argument that occurred recently?
Well, we already sent out kind of breakdown of what the players received. We paid each player for when they were in international duties and quarantine $100 CI dollars per day, per diem, right? We pay all of them $30 CI per training session. So all these things were clarified. So payments were made. Of course, could be 1 week delayed because reparations could delay the process somehow, but not because it did not want to pay, right? So, well, in fact, people now cry when we get 1 week delay because sometimes our finance department have to process 300 checks, right? And then we get 1 week delay. But in the past, CIFA was delaying 1 year or two to pay their bills, right? Right now, we don't have anybody knocking our doors for us to pay the bills, right? Anyways, but all the situation mentioned about, oh, we did not have money to buy fruits, we did not have money to buy water, or I need to get a taxi to go there and come back, this and that. That sounds very strange to me and doesn't make sense at all. First of all, I never ever said no to any of the staff members when they asked me something for the team. And that was mentioned at that meeting, and none of the staff came back and said, oh, Marcos, Alfredo, when I need to buy $30 in fruits for the team, you say no. Nobody came up on that, right? But in fact, we spent just from January to June more than $700,000 just for the men's program. And that don't count the coach salary, the full-time coach salary that will work the team, like Alex, Coach Claudio, and Coach Ben. Talking just about the expenses for the traveling, for the allowance, all the expenses we had for training sessions here in Cayman, and for the staff payments, we went over $700,000 in 6 months. So, and then he come talk to me about, oh, we didn't have money to buy a piece of bread. Right? It doesn't make sense.
COVID test was done at the hotel so the players wouldn't have to break their concentration to go and get it done and come back. We brought the lab to the hotel to get it done. Right? We add additional bonus for winning that we were sure that 2 games we should have won.
Right. And the executive agreed to give $15,000 per win.
For win and $7,500 for draw.
CI dollars.
Bermuda.
To split with the team.
Bermuda said that they would not spend any more money on senior national team players. So Bermuda showed up with a U-20. That's the draw that we had. And when we watch the game against Aruba was less team than Cayman, but they have more will.
And they beat us. A team that doesn't have one field in Aruba that they can play an official match.
They just had that will, and they run 15% more than Cayman, and they beat us. And for us, that was a shocker. Right? We never did went at none of the coaching staff and point fingers and this and that. It's the opposite. Because we also was accused as interfering with coach's decision. If I had interfered with coach's decision, most likely would have won the game. If we was a little bit stronger, more demanding, things wouldn't happen. Right? But on the bright side of it, this is the first time in many years, right, that we don't have players getting sent off, coaches and managers getting sent off from the field of play, right? That always was a problem for us. The last international tournament that we have here, we sat down and we watch our manager get sent off, our coaches.
The coach was sent off first.
The coach gets sent
then
off.
The manager started coaching the team.
Then the manager went and in decent language and got sent off. At least we didn't have to go through that embarrassment. Mm. Right? But the excuses and the pointed a finger that don't take away the lack of commitment from some players, right? And that is what really hurt the national team from not returning half successful from the last two set of games. That is reality of football. And those that know about football, right, when we talk about it, we agree on that.
You know, by no coincidence, all this stuff is happening at a very a time in football where the election is just right around the corner. If I am not mistaken, it is in November.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to know where you guys are with that, and who do you know off the top of your head that has thrown their name in the hat?
No, it's not yet. We haven't received anything yet because we need to send the notes first, right? So then the candidates will come up for the positions. Up to election in a month prior to the election, right? But you know, we are working to make football happen here, and that's the most important thing, right? So we organize football as never before, and that's the most important thing, right? Let's see, but I'm pretty confident that CIFA is doing a great job,
yeah.
You know.
And Mr. Whitaker, are you going to be throwing your name in the hat?
Yeah, my intention was always on the club that supported me. From the beginning, I mentioned to the club that my intention was to do two cycles. And if, for me to do a third one, have to be something extraordinary, right? I enjoy my granddaughter, and I enjoy my weekends, and it being really difficult to fulfill, but I do it with love, right? Especially when the youth league is around, we're working from 7 o'clock in the morning, and the whole idea is to leave the football in Cayman in a better place than where I receive it. I remember one night, like 3 weeks after election, I was leaving with Marcus from the office like about 11 o'clock. And I said to Marcus, go in and buy me 10 gallons of gas at the gas station. And if I don't fix this, I will burn this place down. Right? Was so much missing things and unfinished things and things that was never started. It was such a chaos, right? And we put in at least 6 months leaving that office almost every day between 10 and 11 o'clock at night to try to get the Football Association in a position where we could breathe a little bit better. We have the visit of FIFA and CONCACAF here in Cayman without nothing to offer. And then look at the projects that already had started and where it was going. And we met at CIFA office. Initially, the visit was for 3 hours, I think. And we had breakfast at CIFA office. We never went nowhere fancy.
Mm.
And we went at Casanova's for lunch. And we sit there, and there was the same food for everybody. It was nothing fancy. So whatever FIFA president was eating, I was eating, Armando, and the rest of the guests, there was nothing special there. And that visit for 3 hours went on to almost 5.5 hours. And before leaving, the president said, congratulations, what you're doing is great. It's such a big change. And your funding is coming your way back. And 1.5, 2 months after that, we start to receive our funding back to continue a program. When I look now and we have a U23 league that just finished with 6 teams, and the players is telling you, huh, we wanted another round. Mm-hmm. When I look back and I see our first division that had 11 teams, 95% of the players was born Caymanians, and not the graveyard first division team that we used to have with players that was 35 and 40 years old playing there. And all of these players are average 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 years old. And we have 11 teams. Mm. And I look at that, the way it was played, right, is such a big satisfaction. When I look at the Premier League, that didn't have that gap between the first 3 places, that normally would be 10, 15 points, and you have the top 5 teams right there. And I go, wow, if we had played another round, would be something different. When we start to look at the numbers of spectators coming back to the game, yeah, and especially when we receive an email from FIFA stating that they wanted to come and do a documentary about our youth league. The Cayman Islands Football Association is the only association at the CFU and CONCACAF level, right, that organize such numbers of youth games, youth leagues.
But you guys are planning to expand the CIFA building?
Yeah, we're going to build another field because we are about to complete the floodlights project. We need, of course, when you build another field and the floodlights will be on, we need to have additional parking space. So all these kind of things, you know. So we have an architect already draw a good plan for us.
I'm very, very satisfied to what have been achieved in the past 3.5 years. And we're looking forward to another 4 years of success where we could give the footballers, right, a nice building, nice finalized CIFA for excellence, right? Now we have transportation, we start to grow in that, right? So I think the work had been hard, but it had been good.
Absolutely, and I want to leave it there, guys. I want to thank you both for coming in and giving me the time and speaking about on a number of topics that has been out in the public. And I want to also thank the viewers for tuning in. This is it from me, CIFA Russell Jr., saying until next time.